Last month, Metro Bank became the first Philippine financial institution to be named the strongest bank for the third straight year by the Asian Banker. The bank also sustained its strong performance in the first half of 2023 with a bottom line of 20.9 billion pesos.
Let's talk about the future of Metro Bank and the latest banking trends with Fernand Antonio Tansinco, Senior Executive Vice President of Metro Bank. I'll just call you Toto.
Please call me Toto.
Hi. Thanks for joining us here.
I'm glad to be here.
I heard that Metro Bank's chairman, Arthur T, is very much a fan of the fortress balance sheet of Jamie Dimon.
Yes.
And has this helped in securing that three-peat award from the Asian Banker and other awards besides? And how would you sustain this strategy moving forward?
Yes. For Metro Bank, the most important thing is to keep our depositors' money safe. And because as our late group chair once said, Dr. George SKT, banking is a business of trust. So first and foremost, more than profitability, more than any other consideration, we would like to strengthen our balance sheet and keep ourselves strong because we know that we are the custodian of our customers' trusts. So that's why we've embarked on this strategy of remaining strong despite all the headwinds that could come our way.
And that strength is particularly shown in the balance sheet performance, right?
Yes.
You have, I think you have ability to scale, balance sheet growth, risk profile, profitability, asset quality, and liquidity.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
And how do you plan to sustain that? What's the specific strategy for Metro Bank?
Yes. I think that the headwinds right now in the industry is not yet over. We're just coming out of the pandemic, and right after the pandemic, then we now see the geopolitical risks in the world, which I think we've been talking about. So I think that at this time, it's really good to be prudent and not to let our guards down. We're also seeing a lot of headwinds domestically. Our economy is not growing as strong as it should be. Inflation remains high. And I think a lot of corporates still have not returned to pre-pandemic operational efficiencies and performance. So with this backdrop, we would like to keep our capital ratios high. We would like to keep our loans provisioning high. But at the same time, we would like to balance this out with profitability to our shareholders and our stakeholders to be able to give a good mix of strength and performance.
We're talking about headwinds. A while ago, we reported about the projection of a possible global economic slowdown by the IMF. We have inflation higher for longer, interest rates, supply problems, that war in Russia, the Russia and Ukraine war. I don't think they factored in the Israel-Hamas war yet.
Yes.
But despite all of these, do you see any possible silver lining or anything exciting to watch out for in the coming year or years?
Well, we were just talking before the program started about the crisis that we've been through, the Asian financial crisis, global financial crisis, and recently the pandemic. And one thing that we have to really remember is we have to bet on sanity. I mean, despite all the headwinds during the Asian financial crisis and even during the pandemic, when things seem to be collapsing, there's always a silver lining. And there's, I think that we have resiliency as a world and as an economy, but also as Filipinos to withstand these headwinds. And for those of you who recall that these were opportunities to actually enter into markets. If you picked up, let's say, stocks during the height of the pandemic, then you would have increased it 50%, right? So bet on sanity, I think, is the thing that I can leave our viewers with.
I think I remember at the height of COVID, people were saying, winter is coming.
Yes.
People will not pay banks their loans, and the banks will all, you know, fall. We did not see that.
I realized
people bet on sanity.
Yes,
that's what you're saying.
Yes, and in fact, we're seeing a recovery better than expected. We're seeing, at one point in time, we were projecting NPLs to go to as high as 6%. It never reached there. I mean, We see resilience in our industries because a lot of our companies have gone through the Asian financial crisis and the global financial crisis and have kept their balance sheet strong, have not taken the risks that would have toppled them. So I think that we have a very seasoned industry, we have a maturing economy, and we have good people in our companies running them.
The stock price today closed at 51.70.
Yes.
That's down 4.26% year to date, way behind BPI and BDO, the two other banks. You spin this as, that's a good buy now. Return on equity is really high compared to the other banks. But how do you explain the very, you know, steady, steady movement of the stock?
Yes, I think that for Metro Bank, we really play long term. I mean, you know, if some of the players want to get a quick buck, of course they would go for other counters. But for us, we've always thought of things in years, not quarters. Mm-hmm. And that's why, for example, Metro Bank's ROE seems muted compared to what it is. But guess what? It's muted because we're bringing, carrying such a big capital base to ensure that our depositors are safe. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we're playing the long game and we're making sure that we have a sustainable business despite any headwinds. And I think that another thing that we need to do in Metro Bank, and we're busy doing it, is to communicate more our strategy. Mm-hmm. I think a lot of people don't understand us. They just look at the headlines. It is unfortunate that in the Philippines, our market liquidity, especially the stock market, has really gone really low. So a lot of times, the investors no longer dig through the numbers. They just look at the headlines and make their investment decisions. But I think it's incumbent for all of us, the media, the banks, a bit, even the public, to tell the Philippine story. And that's what we're hard at. Right now, we're going out, we're talking to investors, and telling them to look at things in the long term.
The industry now is seeing the rise of fintech companies, digital banks, digital-only banks as well. They're shaking up the industry, offering almost all of the services that are being offered by traditional banks. I do want to know, how is Metro Bank adjusting to its strategy to possibly keep up or stay ahead of that?
Yes. I think that our DNA in Metro Bank is a business bank. And there's room for a lot of players in the industry. So there's really room for digital banks, there's room for consumer banks, and there are room for business banks. And for us, we're developing apps and digital offerings that are relevant to our customers. And if you look at a lot of the digital offerings, you see a lot of convergence. They seem to look all alike. But for us, I think that we're developing things that are relevant to our customers. For example, our average daily average balances of our customers are typically higher than most retail banks. So we put extra security to ensure that our digital offerings are the most secure that we can make it. So why? Because this is what is relevant to them. In the same way that we also cater to the consumer, we have free payments for 1,000 pesos and below until the end of the year, so you can transfer at will, because we would also want to be relevant. So we don't want to join the fray and give what everybody else is offering. We would like to give what is relevant to our customer base.
Is it a competition? Or do you see the digital banks? There's a digital banking war already.
Yes. I think that there's a digital banking war, and in fact, there are bank financial institutions already competing. But for us, I think if we stick to our core competency, if we serve our target customers the best that we can, then I think that we will go through this very well.
Most of the banking executives that we've talked to here, their key word is always about inclusivity, right? You did mention that you view Metro Bank, or Metro Bank is more of a business bank, but what have been the activities of the bank towards inclusivity?
I think that we've really upped our offerings as far as our offerings to the businessmen, our offerings to their employees, and our offerings to their customers. So we target all the aspects of their business, and we try to have an offering, a strong offering, to all these areas. On top of that, our foundation is one of the most active. So for those that are not our customers, we would like to be able to help them. Teachers, policemen, soldiers are some of
them.
Yes. So those are advocacy, and it's very enlightening to hear stories of how Metro Bank was able to help people out of poverty.
Okay, I'm gonna have to speak very quickly because I have two more big questions for you. In terms of the industry as a whole, bank lending is not yet back to pre-pandemic levels. It's parang softening, although Metro Bank, it has held up, no? What's the outlook on lending and profitability for the industry as a whole? And I guess NIMS will hold up, no? Because of the higher for longer scenario.
Yes, I think that lending will follow the GDP, and unfortunately our GDP slipped a bit on the second quarter. I think that there's a lot more headwinds as inflation is taking a bite on people's spending power, and thereby delaying a lot of consumption. Companies are delaying a lot of expansion, and this will probably temper the loan growth. But I think that this is a good sign. This is a sign of prudence, a prudence of our consumers, and also prudence on our of our companies. And they will probably it will probably taper back a bit. But as the economy recovers, we'll be there for strength.
Gosh, one more, Ron.
I'm Go ahead.
This. Investments, of course. We can't end this show without asking the Toto Tansinko, where can money be made now? You're not worried about the Israel conflict.
I think that the biggest the biggest challenge for investments now is inflation. How do you keep your money intact despite inflation? So if you go through the PSE right now, we're already trading at around 11, 12 times PE. So that's a good value. Number two is there are several companies trading at below book value. With good outlook and with good earnings and with good dividend yields. So ask your broker, what are the companies that meet this criteria? And I think that this will be able to tide you over this with this high inflation pressure and give you a good upside.
Bonds still are no-brainer. It's still high. If bonds, rates will go, continue to be high.
I think right now, if you look at the, if the Philippines can keep its inflation rate at around 4% long-term, not only this year, but long-term, then a bond at 6%, 6.5%, or even 7% is good value. So this is now an opportunity for some people to live on interest. Buy assets now to live on interest 3, 5, 10 years from now.
Thank you, Toto. You're always welcome. We always lack time when we talk to you. Thank you so much for being here.
Thanks.